Okay, I'm just going to say in advance that I have a lot to tell you in a short amount of time, so it might go a little quick, but trust me, I'll slow down for the important parts. First of all, I have no conflicts of interest. In fact, I'm actually pretty good at losing a lot of money as I do a lot of this research, as you'll find out in a moment. First, a little bit about me. You might not recognize this picture. You'll see why in a moment. I am a business developer and entrepreneur, but I consider myself first and foremost a software engineer. Engineering is very important to me as far as breaking down the science. This is me now, of course, because I started keto in April of 2015, and I had 7 blissful months of feeling better than I ever had in my entire life. Then a dark day came in November 2015 where I got my cholesterol. Sure enough, it was far higher than I ever would have thought. Both my sister and my dad, who were inspired to take on the diet, did not have an explosion in their cholesterol numbers, so I was very surprised to see that, sure enough, I was what we call in the low-carb community a hyper-responder. This was, of course, the point where things got a bit harder, and I then decided to start learning everything that I could about cholesterol and the lipid system. This seemed to be a common thing that I kept running into in trying to learn about cholesterol, which it seemed that there was a lot of people that inside the field had already kind of the opinion that cholesterol was absolutely the culprit. It was the reason everything was going haywire. It was just a matter of time until they got together the evidence that they needed to get it working. However, for me, the more that I was learning about the network that it was, the more it felt like a distributed object network that I see all the time as a software engineer. So more and more, the more I saw it, the more I kept thinking, am I just projecting my own software engineering onto it, or is this in fact a network? And that's where I kind of got set up for the right moment for the next test that I was going to do. The next blood test I was going to do was going to be 2 weeks after the first one, because I basically kind of wanted to get a second opinion. And even though I'm going to show you a lot of fancy graphs in a moment, this is probably the most relevant one to me because it's what started me on this journey. As you can see here, my dietary average of fat, or my 3-day average of dietary fat, was around 224 when I took that first test and got the 329 score. 2 weeks later, I was miserable, and I decided I was only going to have saturated fat when I really felt like I had to have it. And therefore, I actually climbed all the way down to 83, but I was still on a ketogenic ratio. And this is what happened to my total cholesterol. Now, here's the best part. I'm pretty sure I may be the only person in the world that was ecstatic to see his cholesterol jump by 100 points. The reason is because before that day arrived, if in fact this was an inversion pattern, this is what would confirm it, even if this was just 4 data points. From that point, I decided I was going to enter into a very extreme N-of-1 experiment. To say I'm an extreme N-of-1 is kind of like saying the surface of the sun is a little bit warm. As many of you already know, I take measurements on a constant basis. I take my glucose, my ketones, I take my blood pressure every morning. I actually take pictures of everything that I eat, often constantly measuring it. And that's everything. That includes supplements, that includes drinks, that includes water. And if I can't actually measure it, you'll see prominently in a lot of the pictures that I have in my phone, my left hand. Why? So that I always have a reference for volume. The reason I need to get all of this data is because I'm matching it against a lot of blood tests. When I say a lot of blood tests, I mean a lot of blood tests. I've had about 51 blood tests in the last 15 months. The reason I want to set you guys up for this is because I need you to understand how serious I am about this information I'm about to bring to you. So, now let's talk about what I like to call the inversion pattern. First, just a tiny bit of a recap. While a low-density lipoprotein is far more complex than this, these 3 parts we're going to be talking about a lot. So I need you to be familiar. When I say low-density lipoprotein, when often you see on a test an LDLP, for those of you who are big geeks, I mean ApoB-containing lipoproteins. The rest of you guys don't need to know that. Just know when I say LDLP, that's what I'm talking about. But inside of these LDLPs are both triglycerides and cholesterol. And I want you to take note in this moment, which is more prevalent, the triglycerides or the cholesterol? That'll become important later on the test. You didn't know there was going to be a test, did you? Okay. About this time last year, I ran into these friendly fellows who were setting up Low Carb Vale, and I probably talked about 1 million miles an hour, and I had a tough time kind of getting across to them this cross between the lipid system and it being kind of an engineering mechanism. And it was really difficult to get across these doctors. I kind of wish that there was just like another engineer that happened to be there and might know something about cholesterol. And luckily, I did in fact run into somebody. So sure enough, I got to talk with Ivor quite a bit, told him that the next obvious step from a scientific standpoint is, even if I got this over 3 months, going probably about, I think it was something like 13 to 14 days between each test, that the next obvious step was to see if I could suss out this pattern, but this time doing it one day after the next. So for 7 days in a row, I had my blood test, or I had my blood drawn for each day. And every single one of those tests include an NMR, which is a nuclear magnetic resonance test, to be sure that I got deep cholesterol numbers for the stratification of everything. I ate to a diet plan to induce this curve. So would I then see the inversion pattern? I did. That's exactly what happened. That happened over a total of 6 blood tests, 5 that were one day after the next, and then the trailing Monday of the next day. And as any engineer will tell you, the next obvious step is to step on the gas. So I went ahead and saw if I could induce a big drop by bringing up my cholesterol to 349 grams of fat. That's exactly what happened. Brought it down to 218 LDL-C, which, by the way, up to this point is the lowest score that I'd had since going on a ketogenic diet. Okay, so let me break this down. Here's where I get slow, because I want you to walk away knowing this. This is the inversion pattern broken down for LDL-C. It's 3 days before the morning of the blood test. So if I took a blood test this morning, Sunday morning, then that means I could take yesterday, Saturday, the day before that, Friday, and the day before that, Thursday, take those together, and from that I could determine what the pattern's going to be against what my LDL-C is. So the next graph I'm going to show you is a fast forward to the first 29 data points I had past Vail. And all of the couplings that you're seeing there are just those two placed together. So to put it a different way, it's only those 3 days in the orange. And it's the corresponding resulting LDL-C that's in the blue. To make this a little bit easier for you to see this inversion pattern, I'm going to invert that axis on the left-hand side. Are you ready? That's what it looks like. Now again, this is a relative comparison. So as you see, the axes at the bottom do not start at zero. This is so we can make a direct comparison. But to help it out for you geeks, you can see the Pearson score, you can see the regression. R squared and Pearson are extraordinarily closely correlated. And just to overlay it and just to punctuate the point just a little bit more, every single one of these couplings are only the 3 days of dietary fat before and the resulting LDL-C. We do have some anomalies, but I include all of them. And I think it's a total of 3 at data points 19, and pretty close to the end at like 27. Okay, check this out. No inversion pattern here. This is HDL-C. HDL correspondingly rises with the amount of dietary fat I have. The Pearson and the regression are not as tight, but as you can kind of see visually, it's because there seems to be a floor to how low the HDL-C will go. That's probably a good thing. Now, I want to talk about LDL-P, again, the particles that contain the LDL-C. The particle count, as Jeffrey Gerber has mentioned, as Ivor's mentioned, many other people have talked about, this is kind of the new wave of lipidology concern for what is actually concerned for atherosclerosis. And what we found is that the more that I was crunching the data, the more it actually went on a slightly different equation. It still goes by a 3-day window, but there was a 2-day gap. So to go back to my previous example, if I took my blood test this morning, I would ignore Saturday and Friday, and I'd go to Thursday, Wednesday, and Tuesday. The graph I'm about to show you includes all of those same data points that I showed from before, except this time it's against that equation for LDL-P. So the dotted line this time, the dotted orange line, remember, is slightly different because it's that 3-day window with the 2-day gap. I'm going to invert the axes again so that you can see the correlation visually. This is an even stronger Pearson correlation and an even stronger regression. And thus far, by the way, while I don't have all of the data that I It's a little bit outside of the scope of this that I can include the data past August, because at that point I introduced exercise and that has a small impact on it. I can tell you that LDLP is the most consistent of all of the different things that I track. And sure enough, LDLP is the one that is the most relevant as far as driving a lot of the factors associated with it. I also wanted to show you small LDLP. Small LDLP, which I've seen a million articles on online up to this point, is oftentimes talked about on these different ways that you can take care of it, given that it's considered atherogenic. But small LDLP flattens out the higher I get, as you can see, where I get more comfortable having more dietary fat. It's often getting down to the under 90, which is to say it's immeasurably small. So now let's talk just a moment about the theory behind the inversion. And really, this theory is kind of Occam's razor. But once you learn enough about lipidology, you actually can get a sense of what's going on behind it. The problem is, I need to first get you into an engineering mindset. And to do that, I need to impress upon this one very important point. A low-density lipoprotein has many jobs. It's really cool, lots of things that it does. But its primary job is to distribute energy from fat. I probably didn't emphasize that enough. So I'm going to put in all caps, boldface, and underline. The primary job of a lipoprotein is to distribute energy from fat. I'm just going to throw in just one more slide. Increase the font size and really impress upon you that I know cholesterol has been a shiny object with a white hot spotlight on it, and the genius of Ansel Keys is he's gotten us to learn about lipoproteins backwards. But it's very arguable that from payload size, from activity, without question, lipoproteins' main job, what they're doing all the time, is dropping off triglycerides, which are bundles of free fatty acids that all of us on a low-carb diet are utilizing a lot. So, to use a simple analogy, if we were to take a cruise ship, we think of this as the LDLP. What's the triglycerides? The people, yes, the passengers. Okay. If we extend it further, then what's the cholesterol in this? It's the life rafts. You see, cholesterol is constantly onloaded into the lipoproteins, and they do make lots of trips around our vascular system, but are lipoproteins constantly dropping off cholesterol? No, but they are constantly dropping off triglycerides. A lot of the cholesterol is ultimately making its way back to the liver to have many other fates, such as hormones, such as bile salts, and so forth. So again, if you can think like an engineer, watch what they're doing throughout the course of their existence. So yes, per what Jeffrey Gerber was bringing up, they also have secondary jobs such as, say, distributing fat-soluble vitamins. Very important. But that, too, has a higher activity rate than the cholesterol itself. Okay, so now we're kind of coming into what is going on when we're actually measuring the cholesterol in the blood. To do that, I've got to teach you about just two different classifications of the LDLPs. The chylomicrons, which I like to just say is fat-based energy from food that you just ate. And in about 1 to 5 hours, some would say within minutes, depends on who you're reading, they may be going strong, but generally by now, they're almost all getting swallowed up by the liver. Basically, in 6 to 12 hours, they're gone. However, energy that you're getting from storage is ultimately getting synthesized by your liver. Fat-based energy from storage, these guys come in the VLDL-originating lipoproteins, and they're still going strong. I like to call the guys at the top the sprinters. They're quickly running. They're dropping off all their energy. Whew, they're at the finish line, which is the liver. These guys are the distance runners. And why is that so important? It's so important because when am I getting my fasted blood draw? I'm getting it at about 12 to 14 hours, as you should be, if you're getting a blood draw. What does that mean? That means there's only fat-based storage LDL particles, the ones that originate as VLDLs, that are getting measured. So the cholesterol that is left in those LDL particles is what you see. And that's why they become an excellent proxy to see what my body is doing. So this is a highly oversimplified cartoon, but basically, this is it in a nutshell. It seems as if my body is looking at things in a three-day window. And in that three-day window, going backwards, it says, oh, we're in a state of abundance. Lots and lots of incoming energy from the GI tract. I guess I can downregulate. I don't need to upregulate as much of the VLDLs from storage, which makes perfect sense. Conversely, let's say I'm in a state of scarcity. I'm not eating a lot of food, particularly if I have low levels of glycogen stores. It makes a lot of sense as to why my body would say, actually, we need to upregulate VLDLs. We need to be sure that there's lots of available circulation of those triglycerides for the cells to feed us, for the cells to be fed. Okay, the obvious next step after I had all of this compiled data as an N of one was to do what I like to call the identical diet experiment. And I'm happy to say I'm joined in the audience by my sister, who decided to jump in the fray with me. Now, once again, I am a hyper responder. These numbers would scare the heck out of my GP, and they have. I've gotten a chance to show them a lot of the data since, though, so I've kind of changed some minds. My sister, however, is 6.5 years older, and her cholesterol numbers, even though she's ketogenic, got bumped a little bit, but otherwise would look pretty good. Total cholesterol of 230, and her LDL cholesterol is almost half of mine. So what we did is we ate exactly the same food for 13 days. It takes a family member to really dive in for something like this. And I was so adamant about making sure that we got this right, I measured just about everything. I even went so far, as she'll tell you, to actually cook the scrambled eggs in separate pans so they wouldn't commingle and possibly throw off the weight grams, right? Our total cholesterol is reflected here. I'm in the blue. She's in the pink. And I'm going to overlay the dietary fat that we had, the 3-day dietary fat, and you can see how both of us are moving inversely to the amount of 3-day average of dietary fat that we had from before. But to keep this a little more interesting, I'm not going to show all the graphs in three different directions. I'm just going to show our numbers compared to each other. Once again, she's almost at half mine, but yet her magnitude of change is about the same as mine. This is a relative comparison. So the axes, the pink axis on the left is hers, the blue axis on the right is mine. So you can visually see how tight this correlation is. It is a 0.94 on the Pearson. Check out LDL cholesterol. Likewise, on a relative comparison, they're almost identical. LDL particle count, I like to be transparent with all of my data. We did have one confounder. The very last one, which I put in red, she had had around, I want to say, a 1201, which I wasn't expecting. I'd like to think that it's a lab error, but it could have been something else. I don't know. But if we did do another graph where we excluded that very last day, then we do have a Pearson of 0.78 and also an excellent regression. But even more interesting, just a few of the also-rans, HDL cholesterol and triglycerides. This was a major turning point because while I saw all of my lipid numbers moving up and down in comparison to the amount of dietary fat I had, now I had my sister as well at very different levels, not only changing in relative comparison, but in absolute comparison with HDL cholesterol and triglycerides. Triglycerides really amazed me because that's actually a measurement of the energy in the blood contained by those lipoproteins. Finally, I decided to do the extreme drop experiment, and that's where a lot of you in the audience may have known me from. I decided to go ahead and do a presentation in KetoGen seminar. This is the first public presentation of my data, and I decided to wrap one of my most extreme experiments around it. So I was taking it on October 9th. I took a picture of myself getting my blood taken 2 days before October 9th on October 7th, and I said, you're going to see the most massive drop in LDL cholesterol, even though I haven't yet taken the blood test that I'm taking on October 10th. That's why I had to put a silhouette up there, because it hadn't yet happened. So what happened? Well, this is the timeline. October 4th, 5th, and 6th, I ate a very small amount of food. I took the blood test on October 7th, and that's when I started to ramp up the total amount of food that I had to 5,000 calories, dietary fat of around 461 grams. And by the way, for all of you guys who like to talk about saturated fat, around 274 grams of fat each day. By the way, that's hard. Just on a low carb, high fat diet, it's very satiating. Getting to 5,000 calories is very difficult. The numbers did, in fact, probably have one of the biggest viral pushes that I've had in the cholesterol thus far. My total cholesterol fell 66 points, LDL-C by 73 points. LDLP, which I read about endlessly on how you want to move from one type to the next of different kinds of fats, of different kinds of exercise, in 3 days, dropped at 1,115 points. At this point, I decided to go ahead and write this up, and I put it up on my blog, cholesterolcode.com. which I originally called the cholesterol drop protocol, but everybody kept calling it the Feldman protocol, so I'm just going with it. Option one is the very basic one, which is just 3.5 days and one blood test. So for 3 days, you have a high calorie but still ketogenic diet, and then go ahead and take a blood test on the morning of. And please, as I tell everybody over and over again, share the data back, whatever happens, whether it works or it doesn't work, I want to know. And option two is the 6.5 days. This one's a little bit better and closer to what I did with keto gains, in that you bring it to low calorie, and that way you can induce a shift by bringing it back to high calorie. And then the 10.5 days for blood tests, that's actually what I did at the keto gains seminar, and I expand on that in the blog. That's actually what I'd like everyone to do, because it establishes more of a data baseline in the first two blood tests, and further establishes it in the last two. You have a lot of advantage of redundancy, and you can also see the particle count association, which you need 5 days to be able to do. Okay, this is where I got lucky, and I actually managed to get a lot of good volunteers to jump in on the fray. Kind of hoped that posting the protocol would help, but sure enough, Bill Davis, if you're watching, thanks for jumping up there first. He did this almost right away. His LDL history, this is from his own text, for quarterly testing over a year and a half was around 138, 109, 174. Probably, I want to say maybe 130s approximately. His very last test being 130. He went ahead and did the protocol of 5,000 calories a day for 3 days, all extra calories coming from fat. He saw the lowest LDL-C score he had ever had at 88. By the way, his HDL exceeded his LDL. It went from 98 to 112. Next, we have Tom Seast, who I wish could have been here, but unfortunately, he's had to stay home. He did a variation, but with a fasting experiment. And it was pointed out to me that actually the black against the blue is in there is supposed to be white text, but I'll highlight it to make it a little bit easier for you. His fasting experiment meant that his 3-day average of dietary fat would slowly drop off. And as I predicted, and as he agreed, probably his LDL-C would climb. Really want to take a moment right now for everyone to realize this. This is after you've fasted, you've dropped your food completely off. LDL-C climbs, and not only that, it peaked at about 3 days into his fast. This will become very relevant in a little bit. Next up, we have Richard Morris. How many people have heard of Richard Morris?
Hello.
He's one half of the Two Keto Dudes. He also joins us in the audience. And he didn't actually do the protocol as I would like, where the blood tests are very close together, but he did kind of a variation of it, and he was one of the first people to do it. He gets a blood test quarterly, and he approximately has about 1,500 calories, 120 grams of fat. And then he decided, what the heck, I'm going to go into it, and he did what I almost want to call the macadamia nut experiment, because that's where most of his fat came from, and this was the test he got. And in the pink next to it, I show what the difference is. So his total cholesterol dropped by 36, his LDL-C dropped by 31. What wasn't expected is his HDL-C also dropped, and that usually goes up. But then again, that one doesn't have as tight of a correlation. After he did that, his GP was quite a bit surprised by it. And when he was going to take his next quarterly test, actually said, you know that thing you did for that guy? Could you not do that again? And sure enough, back to the same, about approximately 1,500 calories, 120 grams of fat, he snaps back almost to exactly what it was from 6 months earlier, which falls in line to my theory that this is more of a preference point and less of a moving target. Next, I have Silvio Furro, who I've had many exchanges with. He's actually a doctor out of Belgium. By the way, I hope I didn't butcher your name. I was impressed because he was able to do the full 10-day protocol. So this first column is 3 days in. He was holding to close to 750 calories, and also he had around 63 grams of fat. And as you can see, he also has a little bit of hypertriglyceridemia. He has a little bit of a higher triglycerides, but then again, because he's at the lower calorie, it was probably boosted to some degree, as you can see with his next set of tests. He brings it up to 5,000, up to about 500 grams of fat, and sure enough, you can see his numbers plummet, especially on the LDL-C side. And I'm going to take the first test and the last test so we can just see the difference specifically. He was also very good with the protocol, and he's been very interested in seeing how this can relate back to his patients. Bringing it up 428 grams of fat, he brings his LDL-C down by 76, his triglycerides down by almost a third. Carl Franklin is hot off the presses, the other half of the Two Keto Dudes. We had him take his blood for his baseline of what he was already eating, which was about 3,000 calories a day, about 255 grams of fat a day. And then we dropped it down for 3 days, And sure enough, his total cholesterol jumped, his LDL-C jumped, his HDL-C went down. The neat thing was is we were able to get the NMRs with Carl, so we were able to also see what would happen with his LDL-P and his small LDL-P. LDL-P jumped by 264 points. Then, 3 days later, after doing 5,361 calories, new record, by the way, at 510 grams of fat, his total cholesterol drops by 58 points. I feel like I've got to keep reminding people this is in the span of 3 days. 3 days, 3 days. These numbers that are talked about online constantly, including within the low-carb community, are talked about as though they're glacial. If that seems to be a running theme that I want to break everybody loose of that, it is. The lipid system is extremely dynamic, and I feel like I want to take just a little extra time and insert it into my talk at a few points, that it's so dynamic and it's so energy-based that we can see how much these numbers that everybody's putting so much thought into can be so easily changed by what the diet is. So, also we notice the big headliner probably is that he's got a drop of 400 points in his LDL-P, down at the bottom right. Thus far, of those people I've actually seen blood work for, not fly-by tweets, those people I've actually been able to see blood work for, 23 who have written to me, it's been 100% success rate so far. Those people who bring the fat up the highest see their cholesterol drop. Of that, 9 have tried out of curiosity. 10 have tried to get their doctor off their back. Of these 10 people, they didn't care what their cholesterol was at all. They said, I would just like to use your protocol to see if this will work for the doctor. And sure enough, they usually contact me and talk to me about it, and I try to give them a little bit of coaching to make sure that they do the protocol correctly. And as always, please share back the data. 4, and I kind of blame Jeffrey Gerber a little bit for this. 4 have used it to improve their life insurance rate. I'm waiting for the first person who doesn't mind me sharing that publicly. Thus far, those 4 do not want me to share that publicly. And now I kind of want to take a moment to tell you about one person who probably had the single biggest impact on me. This is Jill's story. Jill is not her real name, but she gave me permission to share her information, of which I'm just going to speak to by heart. I came across her because a friend had told her about my blog after hearing her toiling from her third cholesterol test. What happened was that she had gone on a ketogenic diet about a year ago, and this is probably a familiar story a lot of you have heard. She felt better in just about every way, functionally cured her type 2 diabetes, functionally cured her hypertension, and was absolutely certain her numbers, her blood numbers, were going to be better than they ever had been in their life. And they were in the area of inflammation. But her cholesterol number was the one number that jumped up, which her GP immediately jumped onto and said this to her: what good is a ketogenic diet if you won't be alive to enjoy it? She then decided she was going to take another cholesterol test, and this is the story I keep hearing over and over again, decided to be good and therefore bring down her saturated fat. She brought down her saturated fat, took the test 2 weeks later, and the number was higher. She then did a third test, at this point in tears, where she fasted all 3 days. And it was the highest one that she had, and she was awestruck. She actually thought that she might have had some kind of disease that was currently just leaking cholesterol into her body. She didn't know what to think. When she came across my blog, that ended up being something very impactful for her, and she decided then that she was going to do the protocol. But here's the worst part. She was deathly afraid of having any saturated fat past that point. At that point, it was so hard for her to even get to a normal amount of saturated fat, but she decided, as she rationalized to me in the emails, that it was going to be her swan song, her last chance to have it, and so she ate as much as she could, which ended up actually not being that much compared to my protocol. All of our numbers, of course, improved, and her cholesterol score went way down. She brought it to her GP, who didn't have any answer for her, and she promptly fired him. I still get a little emotional when I read her emails, and I'm telling you, it's the Jills of this world that I'm trying to get this information out for. So in closing thoughts, I want to take you back to one important point that can't be lost. It's not just more fat equals less cholesterol, because there is a preference point. My preference point appears to be higher than my sister's. After going on a low-carb diet, there appears to be a preference point that my body keeps moving my energy up and down toward. But I am an engineer, and when you tell me something's broken, I don't expect to see anything like this. This to me looks like a very strong amount of homeostasis, and until I have strong evidence that it's dysregulation, I'm not inclined to take steps to lower my cholesterol, even for as high as it is. For some on LCHF, this will be dramatically high, like myself, be hyper-responders. And is this bad? We don't know yet. But I have a lot of reason to feel that it isn't. And I actually have probably about 28 different reasons that I could talk to you about offline that I just can't fit into this. But there's enormous issues that I have with the research that Ivor Cummins and I talk about all the time that would never pass in engineering. Just got to fit that in. Why this data may be a game changer: the lipid system is far more dynamic than has been believed. All cholesterol markers, all of them, everyone that I've showed you, are highly influenced by the diet of just the previous 3 days. And all particle markers are highly influenced by the diet of just the previous 5 days. And this pattern is an inversion. It's anti-intuitive in that fashion. The higher the dietary fat, the lower total in LDL cholesterol. I genuinely believe, unless you already have some other metabolic reason or derangement that might be a confounder, I genuinely believe everybody in this audience and everybody in the world has the same cofactor involving. So, next steps. Feel free to try the protocol yourself. It just takes a few days and you can expand the data for all of us. Don't believe me? Prove me wrong. Feel free to try it out. And if you're a low carb celeb, like, I don't know, Jason Fung, maybe Ted Naiman, maybe Jeffrey Gerber, feel free to take your normal cholesterol test that you might be doing otherwise, and then try my protocol. All you gotta do is eat a lot of food, just stay ketogenic ratio, and then take it again. You'll do a lot to advance the cause for all of us. And then finally, I'm currently working on getting a formal study put together. Please let me know if you can help, because I'm not an academic. I'm actually an engineer, and the slow grinding gears of academia do kind of frustrate me sometimes, so I might need some help in that regard. I have a ton of acknowledgments, more than I can really go through, but I especially wanted to call out my sister. Darla, thank you so much for doing this additional research. It really was a turning point for us. And that's my talk. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you again. A little bit of time for Q&A for David. Thanks.
I was under.
I have a quick question. Quick question over here to your left.
To my left. Oh, yeah, go ahead.
One question, just liver enzymes, other parameters, did you look at those to see if there was any impact?
Absolutely. So I track CRP, AST, ALT, and I also keep an eye on ferritin. I do have higher than average iron levels, which I suspect is because I have a lot of food that has iron in it, but I try to keep it close. My CRP is generally at like 0.53-ish, unless I've done some distance running. And I'll have more of that information that comes out later, but that's pretty common for distance running.
But with all the fat intake, you didn't see any blips in the ALT or AST?
No. And in fact, I want to disabuse a lot of people of one of the myths out there, which is that a lot of people on the vegetarian side of the fence will say that a high-fat diet puts a lot of stress on the liver, because they assume, because of the VLDLs that get synthesized in the liver, that that's a lot of what's happening. On the contrary, it's almost exactly the opposite. Your liver gets a vacation when you're on a low-carb, high-fat diet, because again, and you learned this in my talk, most of those chylomicrons are being synthesized in the gut. And there's a trail of trust, as we call it in engineering, when the liver says, I don't need to take care of that. Because your liver is actually a straight-laced partner, metabolic partner, that puts up with your crap all the time. So when you send fructose into your body, guess who has to deal with it? It's your liver. When you send in a lot of fat, liver's like, it's good. Go ahead and pass it through.
Okay. Excellent. Thank you.
Yeah,
hi, Dave. George Newman, thank you for your talk. I'm also an engineer. So I just was pulling up some data. I did a 7-day fast at the beginning of December and then did an NMR and everything. But just looking at the total or the LDLs, it was 170 for me, LDLC. And then I had another test on January 10th with my normal keto diet, which is actually near vegan keto. and my total cholesterol, or my LDLs, were 134.
Interesting.
And so I hadn't tried to max out the fat like you do, but my diet is basically probably 75-80% fat calories, and it was a normal 3 days before that, you know.
And yet you're able to meet that on a vegan diet,
or on it's near vegan.
Interesting.
And most of the fat is monos or olive oil, macadamias, avocados, that kind of thing.
Interesting. Yeah, I'd like to talk to you a little bit offline about that
happen to be APOE4.
yes. And for the record, by the way, I'm a 3-4.
I am also.
Oh, okay, perfect.
Well, first of all, fantastic job, Dave, and the work you're doing is superb. And when I first met you in Vail at the first nine data points, and we both agreed there were no way random, that they were going to go on to mean something big. But the other thing I tell people about your work is that it's a genuine scientific finding, a first. And after billions of dollars spent on cholesterol and all the lipidology of the last decades, I mean, this is truly a scientific finding. And it also calls into question a huge amount of what we've heard in the past. And I just might say to you, from all the work I've done looking at LDLP, I largely believe it's most of its power with outcomes or poor outcomes is associational.
Yeah.
And I think there's been a huge amount of mechanistic putting together of hypotheses that have built it up into the big edifice that it is. But at the end of the day, for LDLP driving bad outcomes, I still reckon it's pretty much mostly associational data.
Yes.
And what would you feel yourself from all your work?
Yes, actually, if I can capitalize on that, there's a bad assumption, I think, that we don't like to make in engineering, in that if a device or an object has multiple uses, multiple hats it wears, that it's overly simplistic to think there's only a single reason for its heightened usage. So I think it's not that surprising, given the things that we learned, say, for the immunological value of LDL, that people who are dying might more often have a slightly higher level of the reparative aspects within their body, and that might be one of them, to where I could see why there'd be association. And that's why, until they can effectively remove or control for the reparative aspects of LDL particles, they can't possibly claim that it's the culprit. They have to do that first to be scientifically accurate. And the problem is that they would say that they can't effectively do that right now. Let's just go ahead and give the benefit of the doubt to cholesterol's bad.
Yeah. And I might just finish on that as well, that a high ApoB, one of its most powerful uses is to reflect insulin resistance. And I think that's where it gets an enormous amount of its power. But if you are not insulin resistant and you have a high ApoB for other physiological reasons, you know, I think most of the historical power of ApoB has been helped by insulin resistance as the underlying pathology driving the bad outcomes. So I think that's where ApoB got a lot of its press over the past decade. So, and one last thing, if you're going to look at ApoB, you really, really ought to look at the ApoB over ApoA1 ratio.
Yes.
You should not leave out ApoA1. But I think the whole world at the moment likes to look at ApoB in isolation, which is actually quite a disgrace, if I could say so.
Just to capitalize on what you said, I always now take an ApoA and an ApoB test with all of my NMRs, and my ApoA is also very high. Fat Emperor, is it fatemperor.com?
Yeah, well. Yeah.
Okay, well, I am going to put in a plug for him, because one of my favorite graphs he has is in the comparison of ApoA and ApoB with different metabolic derangements. So just had to fit that in there. Go ahead.
Thanks, Dave.
Yeah, hi. I'm married to an engineer, but so my question is, how does a female's ovulation cycle influence or come into play? Could that have been the answer to why your sister's outlier
that's
number?
Been brought up before, and I'm actually very interested in that information, which is usually why I try to fit that in whenever a female's chatting back and forth with me. My sister gave me permission to say this. She is postmenopausal, and I knew that probably would be a consideration, because if there's anything that you learn as you learn more about particularly the endocrine system and how it relates back with females and so forth, you guys are just so much more important than we are in the evolutionary chain of things. This is the truth. And so I'm not at all surprised that there's, or wouldn't be surprised if there's a more complex lipid handling, particularly premenopausal, So I, as of yet, I don't really have any of the participants that have done the protocol who have made that apparent, because almost everybody who's done it thus far has been of an age in which they're trying to, they see the doctor more often, and therefore they're more likely to come into this situation.
Would it be your instinct to say, do it away from, you know, your cycle?
If I were to guess, probably. If I were to guess, but it's. I'm really kind of outside my wheelhouse on this one.
Talking to the mic.
I'm sorry. Okay. Women still cycle their hormones even after menopause. It's just the follicle stimulating hormone that doesn't come up, so they don't ovulate. But the estrogen still surges every month, just like it used to. It's my understanding.
Sure. Somebody, maybe somebody
19, 20 else. 20 or 21 under cycle of a woman's cycle is when you would want to check it.
At 19, 20.
Sorry,
or
can you say that again for the mic?
Days 19, 20, or 21 of a female cycle, if she's still cycling any other time, you could just run this test that you want to do.
That's interesting. But definitely the scientist in me would love it if I had a colleague who is female who would, you know, do these same insane levels of tests that I would do. But it's already been hard enough to get my sister to do that much, and it's only because of pure love for her brother that she would go to these extremes. So. Yes.
Yeah. So.
Oh, go ahead.
Jeff Gerber. David, you're to be commended. You've taken a very complex data set and have just condensed it and simplified it so that this audience clearly understand what it is that you're doing.
Thanks.
And you were all over the place last year, and I was trying to follow this because I'm not an engineer. But listen, aside from, you know, getting a lower insurance premium, I can't think of any reason for any of us to do a 5,000 calorie a day fat diet other than just proving what you're...
Exactly.
Yeah. And so for me, you know, what are the clinical implications? You're trying to say that measuring lipoprotein is simply telling us about energy homeostasis.
Yes.
That's going to blow it out the water because... The argument is it fluctuates, and it has nothing to do with cardiovascular risk, other than it being associational junk, as Ivor says.
Yes, yes, and actually, if I could fit in my favorite analogy that kind of illustrates this simply, the highest likelihood of you dying in a vehicle of all the vehicles you will die in is an ambulance. Now, if it's a 1 in 9 chance that you're going to die in an ambulance, obviously you should avoid them because they're death traps, right? Mm. Okay, this is why everybody needs to think of things in terms of the reparative aspects of cholesterol. If there are any at all, and we find that there are, then for the same reason that you wouldn't be surprised to find somebody who died to be near an ambulance, we shouldn't likewise just make that same assumption with cholesterol. And per to your point, yes, if there was more ambulances in the neighborhood, that could be a cause for concern because it could be more people are dying. But it could also be just that I've got a better budget for my ambulances. I just want to take better care of them. I don't know.
Yeah. Right. Hey, we'd better wind up just for now.
He's saying we better wind up for now.
Okay, hopefully that's better. Let's take a 10-minute break. And thanks very much, Dave. Fascinating stuff. Thank you.